morning, everyone. Welcome to the house of the Lord. It's always good to see you in God's house, especially as we begin a service with a very beautiful illustration of believer's baptism. And today is extra special, I guess I would say. They're all good, right? Amen, church? Today is extra special because it's a father and a son being baptized together, and that's pretty neat, right? All right, so worship with me. Okay, go real slow. Excellent work. Hang on to that handkerchief. Oops, that's all right. You'll come stand right back here. Good job. All right, Big Daddy. Good job. Grab my hand right here. This burly young man right here is Josh Stevenson. Of course, as you know, this is Ronnie's son. We're proud to have Josh and Miranda and his family here with us, worshiping with us. Josh came forward a few weeks ago, and he says that I'm a born-again believer, and he's already been baptized, actually, but he just wanted to rededicate his life, mark it, a mark in the sand, so to speak. And he wanted to join our church, and he asked me, would it be okay for him to be rebaptized? And I said, of course. He just wants you to know that he's a born-again believer of Jesus Christ. So he's coming forward today to do just that. Josh, have you done that? Have you asked Jesus in your heart to be your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you know for sure if you were to die today that you'd go to heaven and live forever with him?
Yes.
Well, Josh Stevenson, based on your public profession of faith, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Awesome. Ring that bell. All right, baptistry bell. All right, Noah. Let me see this. You grab my hand like it right there. This is his son, Noah. Noah's a student at Gibson County, I believe, right? How old are you, Noah?
16.
16 years old. Noah came forward the same Sunday, said that he, too, is already a believer in Jesus Christ, but had never followed through with believer's baptism. So he wanted to join us and follow through with God's will for his life to do that public display of his salvation experience. Noah, were you sincere when you asked Jesus Christ in your heart to be your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you believe for sure that if you were to die today, that you'd go to heaven and live forever with him? Well, Noah Stevenson, I'm proud of you, and I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Awesome. Praise God. Ring that bell. Woo-hoo! And all God's people said,
amen.
All right, let me pray with you. Lord, thank you again for this beautiful display, this beautiful observance of believer's baptism. And God, we're all reminded how you died for us and how you saved us. And when we came to know you as our Lord and Savior, Lord, how we died to our old self. We were buried to our old ways. And we were born again, washed clean of our sins, made new in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And we have all of that owing to you, grateful to you for what you've done for us. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen. God bless you.
Good morning. You may be seated. Welcome to Salem Baptist Church. We are absolutely thrilled that you are here to worship with us. So if you're in the room, if you're out in the parking lot listening in the car, we are so glad that you came with us to gather in his name and to worship him. So this will be a wonderful time that we can spend together as a church family. So thank you for that. I'm going to pray. I'm going to let you know what we're planning to do. I'm going to pray in just a minute. And then I'm going to ask Mr. Tracy if he'll come up. And he's going to do something a little special for our teachers and all of our folks that work in the school system. So that's what we're going to get ready to do. But as we get ready to pray and go into that time, I just ask our church family to remember Mr. Ronnie and his wife. Is Ronnie? Oh, there you are, my brother. You blended into the background there, my friend. They are leaving today or tomorrow. Going to Memphis today, fly out in the morning to go to Rochester, Minnesota, to the Mayo Clinic, who are just experts in the field of treating cancer. So they'll be taking some treatments there. So please remember them for safe trip, for wisdom for the doctors, and just for strength and healing and peace from our Heavenly Father that's beyond what we can imagine. So I'm going to ask you, if you will, to just remain seated while I pray, and then we'll go into our time to pray over our school and all of their folks that serve our young people and our families in our community. If you will, pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much this morning for a time where we can worship you. We thank you for a time where we can gather together and remember who you are, what you have done through the picture of baptism. Remember that we died to our old way of life, and now we are raised to walk in a new life with you. And it's not always an easier life, but it's a life we never have to go through alone. We have our church family. We have our Heavenly Father. We have the Holy Spirit in our hearts. We have a heart that is clean and covered in the blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. So I thank you for that. I ask you to be with Ronnie and his wife and family as they get ready to go to these treatments. And I know that these doctors are wise and they know a lot, but they don't know anything near what you know. So God, we are going to rely on you to work in this situation, to keep them safe, and to let your will be done and your name be glorified here and in Minnesota. We love you so much for all that you do for us. And we thank you for this morning and this time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Mr. Tracy, come up, will you?
On behalf of the RAs, GAs, Ms. Kim Thompson, and myself, we have a small gift of encouragement to all the people that work in our school systems. A couple of things. You know how McDonald's has to put that their coffee is hot now because of lawsuits. Well, I've got a couple of public announcements here for the teachers. A couple of the gifts that are in there is one is toothpick to remind you to pick out the good qualities in others. So don't use it to jab your kids when they're misbehaving. The second one is a rubber band to remind you to be flexible. Things might not always go the way you want, but it will work out. So don't use the rubber band to strangle your kids. You know, this is for whether you're a custodian, a teacher, bus driver, a chef in the kitchen. We want to pray over you and give you this. And there's also a Sonic gift card in there to give you that caffeine that you're gonna need. And there might be a few of you that might have needed something a little stronger, but we'd have got fired by Brother Todd if we'd have done that. So we all need a job. So I'm going to ask, if you work in our school systems, you come forward. Brother Todd's going to pray for you. And as you leave, the RAs and GAs are going to have a gift for you.
So if you do work anywhere in the school system, would you just come up front and stand right here? And Ms. Kim, I know you need to stay with the young folks, but she's standing. She's part of our school system too. She just can't come up front right now. But if you do, it doesn't matter, teacher, administrator, drive a bus. It doesn't matter. We have a lot of folks from our church that take part in leading our young people. So this is absolutely wonderful. Thank you all for what you do. Thank you for the influence that you can be on our young folks in areas where I can't. You guys can go beyond what I can do. And I also know that you have to, yes. And I also know that you have to be like Christ in all those situations with those kids. So bless your hearts with that too. But thank you for the witness. And we're going to pray for you that Christ will give you strength so that as you go through this year, you can show that light of Christ in an area that may sometimes be very dark. So thank you for that. We appreciate you guys very, very much. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you have come into our lives We have given our hearts to you. You are our Savior and our Lord, and we want to follow you. But you didn't take us straight to heaven because you left us here to be on mission for you. And so, yes, we have pastors and we have teachers and we have missionaries, but you have called all of us. You've called us pastors to equip our church to go out and be missionaries. So we don't have to go to Africa or Asia or South America to be a missionary. We are on mission wherever we work, wherever we serve, whatever we do. So the folks standing here are on mission as missionaries that we are sending out as Salem Baptist Church to be a witness, to be on mission for you in the public schools in our county and the city schools in many different areas, God. And I don't know what they're going to face this year with sickness, with students, with the lives that these young folks come from that can be sometimes extremely difficult. But God, you know the path. You know where they're going to go. You've already been there. And so when you call them, when you touch on their hearts, they can know that they are being led by the one who knows exactly what the next step needs to be. So I ask you, Lord, to help them to have confidence, to listen to you, to follow your Holy Spirit's leading, and to be a light for Jesus Christ out in our dark world, God. Thank you for the young people that are going to be with them. Touch their hearts even now. Help them to be open to hearing the gospel. Help the other leaders and teachers and folks that they'll work with who maybe aren't followers of Christ to see the light of Christ in their lives, God. The parents, all the people involved, Lord. I thank you for the light that these people can be in your community and in your world to share your gospel of Jesus Christ with so many folks in our community, God. I thank you for them. Give them strength, give them courage, help them to know that their church loves them and cares for them. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, would you let these folks know how much you appreciate them? Thank you. Come on up, RAs and GAs, and get your gift before you go back to your seat.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, I start to fall. When this life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, blessing buried in the broken pieces. every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it. There was Jesus on the mountains, in the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys.
Blessing buried in the broken pieces.
Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, I couldn't see it. There was Jesus. There was Jesus.
Superstitious writing on the wall, sang by Ronnie Stevenson's hero, Stevie Wonder. Is the Bible just superstitious myth, or is it supernatural revelation? Well, today we're going to see that it is definitely supernatural revelation. If you would, take your Bibles, open with me the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 5. You got Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos. Daniel chapter 5. I want to give a shout out to Tony and Amy. Thank you. And Ginger, thank you. God bless you. Appreciate great worship today. And I appreciate you filling in. I know Stephen and Wendy had much needed R&R this week. Good to have y'all back home, by the way. Glad y'all had a great time. And I appreciate the bench is deep at Salem. Amen. And we're grateful that people can rise up to the occasion. And so thank you for leading us. I believe God has a word for us today, church, from Daniel chapter 5. And if you're here, I'm glad you're here. If you're visiting with us today, thank you for being with us. You're welcome here. We're glad that you have come. And we pray that you will enjoy it, and we enjoy having you. Daniel chapter 5, let's begin reading in verse 1. That seemed like a good place to start, right? Belshazzar, the king, made a great feast for 1,000 of his lords. And he drank wine in the presence of the 1,000. Look at verse 5. In the same hour, the fingers of a man's hand appeared and wrote opposite the lampstand on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace. And the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Verse 24. Then the fingers of the hand were sent from God, and this writing was written. This is the inscription that was written. Many... Mene tekel upharsin. Mene, mene tekel upharsin. Church, this is the story of the handwriting on the wall. And from this historical biblical story, this supernatural biblical revelation, I believe God has a word for us today. My message today is, wake up, America. Read the handwriting on the wall. Judgment Day is coming. Now, let's first understand the historical context of this story. And when we understand the historical context, it will help us see then the application for our nation, America, today. As illustrated with this story, we will also see that America will not last. The mighty nation of America, as we know it, is going to end. And when it does, it's not going to be pretty. Just as the nation of Babylon ended, America will also end. And in church, I believe that both America and Babylon will end for the same exact reason. Therefore, whoever trusts in America alone will perish. And that is why we'll see today the need for you to know and to choose God, to follow His way, because His way leads to everlasting life. So let's first begin with the historical context of this story, and then God will give us a word for today for America. Let's read again, chapter 5, let's read verse 1 and 2. Belshazzar the king made a great feast for 1,000 of his lords, and he drank wine in the presence of the 1,000. While he tasted the wine, Belshazzar gave the command to bring the gold and silver vessels, which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken from the temple, which had been in Jerusalem, that the king and his lords and his wives and his concubines might drink from them. Now, who is Belshazzar the king? Belshazzar was King Nebuchadnezzar's grandson. Now it says here, his father, Nebuchadnezzar, but it literally means his forefather. Father, used in the original language here that this was written, is used to mean either dad or forefather, because they had no word in their language at that time that described grandfather or grandson. So, Father Nebuchadnezzar means Belshazzar's forefather, who was in reality his grandfather. But for many centuries, there was no historical evidence that Belshazzar really ever existed. No archaeological evidence, no written evidence that Babylon ever had a king by the name of Belshazzar. For many centuries, Bible skeptics, therefore, had always put forth that this entire account, this story of Daniel, of the handwriting on the wall, was nothing more than myth and fantasy. And they did so because there was no historical evidence to support it, that is, until the 1920s, when archaeological evidence found that Belshazzar was indeed the king of Babylon. And further, irrefutable evidence was discovered in the 1950s. So not only was Belshazzar a real king of Babylon, we now have historical evidence to prove it. And may I say to you, there will never be any archaeological evidence discovered to disprove the Bible. Do you know why there will never be any evidence discovered to disprove the Bible? Because the Bible is true. And you will never find proof to disprove truth. Amen? Now, there may be some things that the Bible mentions that have not been discovered, things like Noah's Ark. We hadn't laid our hands on Noah's Ark. Of course, I think they found it up in Kentucky, didn't they? Didn't you go, Brother Todd? And maybe the Ark of the Covenant, other than what Indiana Jones found. So there may be some things that we haven't discovered, but there will never be any archaeological or historical discoveries to disprove the Bible. You can't disprove truth. So Belshazzar was a real king that ruled in Babylon. Belshazzar's dad was actually King Nabonidus, the son of King Nebuchadnezzar. King Nabonidus and his son Belshazzar were co-kings of Babylon simultaneously. King Nabonidus was out fighting battles, trying to protect the kingdom, and so he made his son Belshazzar king over the city of Babylon. So while King Nabonidus was out fighting, King Belshazzar was at home. He was the king at home in Babylon. Let me show you something interesting that kind of proves this co-kingship that they carried. Look at verse 7 of chapter 5. The king cried aloud, that's King Belshazzar, cried aloud to bring in the astrologers, the Chaldeans, which is another name for religious Babylonians, and the soothsayers. The king spoke, saying to the wise men of Babylon, whoever reads this writing and tells me its interpretation shall be clothed with purple and have a chain of gold around his neck, and he shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. It says here, Belshazzar made a decree that whoever interprets the handwriting on the wall will become the third ruler in the kingdom. Why? Because King Nabonidus was the first ruler, Belshazzar was the second ruler, and whoever interpreted the handwriting would be the third ruler. Belshazzar really did rule in Babylon. The handwriting on the wall really did happen. Now, to get further historical background and support of the story, let's also recall King Nebuchadnezzar. Now, that's a king that you will be familiar with, because understanding him will help us understand this supernatural event. King Nebuchadnezzar, he is the king that conquered Israel and took them captive into Babylon. He destroyed Jerusalem, destroyed the temple, took them captive into Babylon around 587 B.C., The reason he did is because Israel had rebelled against God. And God said, if you continue to rebel against me, after I have provided for you and protected you, if you continue to rebel against me, I will raise up a king to come in to conquer you and to take you into captivity. Well, that's exactly what happened. Nebuchadnezzar came in. Daniel was one of the young captives taken into captivity. He would have been just a young boy at the time. Nebuchadnezzar was that evil king that God raised up. Now, God didn't make Nebuchadnezzar an evil person. Nebuchadnezzar was already an evil person. So God just used the evil in Nebuchadnezzar's own heart to direct him to conquer Israel. Once they were in captivity, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. It's a very famous dream that you may remember. He dreamed of a giant statue. Corey, I have a picture of it on a screen. And so he dreamed about this giant statue, had a head of gold, had chest and arms of silver, had the middle section of bronze and the legs of iron. He had this dream, and Daniel, the captive Daniel, was the only one that could interpret the dream. God gave him supernatural ability to do so. And so Daniel gave the interpretation of the dream. And if you remember, those represented coming world kingdoms. The head of gold was the Babylonian kingdom that Nebuchadnezzar was king of. The next world kingdom would be the Medo-Persian kingdom, represented by silver. The third kingdom would be Greece. Remember Alexander the Great and the Greek kingdom. And then the legs of iron was Rome, and they were the world kingdom when Jesus was crucified. So Nebuchadnezzar had this dream. Daniel interpreted the dream. When Nebuchadnezzar realized that he was the head of gold and that his kingdom was the strongest of the world empires, Nebuchadnezzar became puffed up, and he became even more arrogant than he already was. And because of his arrogance, God punished Nebuchadnezzar, and he lost his mind. He went crazy. He went mad. Therefore, he was exiled from the royal palace, and he instead lived in the wilderness as a wild animal. His hair grew long, his beard grew long, his fingernails grew long. He ate grass just like an ox, as a wild animal. While in exile, because he had lost his mind, that is when his son, Nabonidus, and his grandson, Belshazzar, became co-kings of Babylon. But while Nebuchadnezzar was in exile because of his madness, he actually repented of his sins. Nebuchadnezzar recognized that God Jehovah was the only true God. I believe Nebuchadnezzar most likely is in heaven today because he had repented of his sins. Now, all of that's an unusual story about Nebuchadnezzar being the greatest and losing his mind and eating grass and then repenting. But King Belshazzar, his grandson, was fully aware of all of that. He knew all about it because Nebuchadnezzar was his granddaddy. But though he knew about it, he did not learn from it. Look at verse 22. But you, his son, Belshazzar, have not humbled your heart, although you knew all of this. Belshazzar had not learned from his grandfather Nebuchadnezzar. And Belshazzar, as we will see, he was even more arrogant, more prideful than his grandfather was. And while the father and son team, Nabonidus and Belshazzar, were co-kings, it was during that time that empire number two began to rise to power, this Medo-Persian empire. And the Medo-Persian empire was rising up, and they were conquering. And as this new kingdom was making their way towards Babylon to defeat Babylon and become the ruling world power, King Nabonidus went out to stop them as they approached the city. But Nabonidus was defeated, and he was defeated badly. So his son, King Belshazzar, who was the king inside the city walls, how did he respond to the news upon hearing that his dad was defeated by this up and rising new power and that his city was surrounded by the enemy? How did he respond? Did he mount up to fight? No. Did he call the military to battle stations? No. Did he warn the inhabitants of the impending doom? No. He threw a party. He threw a party. You see, Belshazzar hadn't learned a thing from the life of his grandfather. Belshazzar was nothing more than a little rich spoiled brat. And he lived in the royal palace. He slept on silk sheets. He didn't prepare for battle. He instead threw a drunken feast. And if that hadn't been enough, he even ridiculed God Jehovah. Now, understanding all of that historical background, we're ready to take a close look at this episode of the handwriting on the wall. Let's look again at verse 1. Belshazzar the king made a great feast for 1,000 of his lords and drank wine in the presence of 1,000. While he tasted the wine, Belshazzar gave the command to bring the gold and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken from the temple, which had been in Jerusalem, that the king and his lords and his wives and his concubines might drink from them. Then they brought the gold vessels that had been taken from the temple of the house of God, which had been in Jerusalem. And the king and his lords and his wives and his concubines drank from them. They drank wine, and they praised the false gods of gold and silver, bronze and iron, wood and stone. Even as his own father was defeated, even as his own city was surrounded by the enemy, even as impending doom was at the door, Belshazzar threw a party. And if that hadn't been enough, he even ridiculed God Jehovah. And it was at that moment that the handwriting on the wall came. Look at verse 5. In the same hour, the fingers of a man's hand appeared and wrote opposite the lampstand on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace, and the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Then the king's countenance changed, and his thoughts troubled him, so that the joints of his hips were loosened and his knees knocked against each other. Belshazzar sees the handwriting on the wall, and it scares the bejeebies out of him. So he called for all the astrologers, all the soothsayers to come and interpret the handwriting. They couldn't read it, and no one could interpret it. But the queen mother, she had heard of that Hebrew named Daniel. And so she suggests, why not bring up Daniel the Hebrew? Let him have a try. So Belshazzar sends for Daniel. Daniel walks into the palace room where he is. He looks the king in the eye. He tells Belshazzar, yes, he can interpret the dream with God's help, but he didn't want any of his gifts. Then Daniel tells him the absolute truth to his face. You gotta love Daniel. Well, let's read what he said. I want you to get the full context of what Daniel told the king that day. It's a little bit lengthy, but we're going to read through it, beginning in verse 17. Then Daniel answered and said before the king, "Let your gifts be for yourself. Give your rewards to another. Yet I will read the writing of the king and make known to him the interpretation. O king, the Most High God gave Nebuchadnezzar, your father, a kingdom and majesty, glory and honor. And because of the majesty that God gave him, all peoples, nations, and languages trembled in fear before Nebuchadnezzar. Whomever he wished, he executed. Whomever he wished, he kept alive. Whomever he wished, he set up. Whomever he wished, he put down. But when his heart was lifted up, his spirit was hardened in pride, he was disposed from the kingly throne and took his glory from him. Then he was driven from the sons of men. His heart was made like the beast. His dwelling was with the wild donkeys. They fed him." They're talking about Nebuchadnezzar. "They fed him with grass like oxen, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven. until he knew that the Most High God rules in the kingdom of man, and God appoints over it whomever he chooses. But you, his son, Belshazzar, you have not humbled your heart, although you knew all of this. And you have lifted up yourself against the Lord of heaven. They have brought the vessels of God's house before you, and you and your lords and your wives and your concubines have drunk wine from them, and you have praised the false gods of silver and gold, bronze and iron, wood and stone, which do not see or hear or know. And the God who holds your breath in his hand, he owns all your ways. You have not glorified. Then the fingers of the hand were sent from God, and this writing was written. And this is the inscription that was written, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin. This is the interpretation of each word. Mene, God has numbered your kingdom and finished it. Tekel, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. Perez, which is the singular form of Upharsin. Your kingdom has been divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Verse 30. That very night, Belshazzar, king of the Chaldeans, was slain. Even as his own father was defeated, even as his own city was surrounded by the enemy, even as impending doom was at the door, Belshazzar threw a party. And if that hadn't been enough, he even ridiculed God Jehovah. And at that exact moment came the handwriting on the wall. And what was written was, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin. Then Daniel the prophet interpreted for the king. He said, Mene, what means Belshazzar and the Babylonians, your days are numbered. Tekel, which means Belshazzar and the Babylonians, your deeds have judged you. Upharsin, which means Belshazzar and the Babylonians, your kingdom has ended. Your days are numbered, your deeds have judged you. Your kingdom has ended. And church, I'm afraid those same words have been written for America too. That very night, Belshazzar died and the Babylonian rule ended. This is how we know the story is true. It was written and then it happened. Now church, from this story, I see the exact same thing that I'm afraid. I see the exact same thing happening to this nation that I love. This nation of America. And not only will the exact same thing happen to America, I believe it's going to happen for the exact same reason. The Bible warns us in 2 Thessalonians that in the last days there will be a great falling away from God and of the things of God. Jesus warns us in Matthew 24 that the world will deteriorate and become like the days of Noah just before Jesus coming. I now submit to you that these things are happening, and they're happening before our very eyes. And from studying the demise of Babylon, I believe the same exact thing is happening right here in America. And for the same reason. Wake up, America. Read the handwriting on the wall. Judgment Day is coming. In this story, we find three reasons why God sent judgment to Belshazzar and the Babylonians. And I'm convinced that America will fall because of the same three reasons. Reason number one, found in Scripture here, misguided masses. The misguided masses. Look at verse 1. Belshazzar the king made a great feast for 1,000 of his lords. And he drank wine in the presence of 1,000. In the face of impending doom, Belshazzar threw a party for all the royals, all the leaders of the city, as it was recorded here, as 1,000 of them. It was probably even more than that. It was the masses of the city. Even as his own father was defeated, his own city was surrounded, impending doom was at the door, Belshazzar threw a party for the masses of the people. Verse 1, it says, for 1,000 of his lords. Verse 2, it says, the king, his lords, his wives, his concubines. Verse 3 says, his lords, his wives, his concubines. It says it time and time again. Then God's judgment was spelled out by Daniel the prophet when he said, in verse 22 and 23, he says, but you, Belshazzar, have not humbled your heart and your lords and your wives and your concubines have drank wine from God's vessels. In the face of destruction, they were misguided. They were the misguided masses. They were right there with the king, following the king, doing as the king did, and now they were led to the same destruction that he was about to receive. They were misguided. They were masses, but they were the misguided masses. I fear that America today is a nation of misguided masses. A nation of misguided masses following the godless leadership of crooked politicians and failed politics, of godless socialism and humanistic social movements, of one world identification and self-exaltation. America is a nation of misguided masses. There's violence in the streets. There's more government control and less personal freedoms. There's an anything-goes philosophy and a complete breakdown and dismantling of anything that is Judeo-Christian principles. Our nation is misguided. Why is it true? Because there's been a long disconnect from the Word of God and from the truth that God has given us. Many years ago, God was kicked out of our schools. Many years ago, God was kicked out of our government. And now that generation has grown up and is in charge. Most Americans no longer teach the Bible. They no longer read the Bible because they no longer believe the Bible. They're misguided. They're masses, but they're misguided masses. God is no longer in our schools. He's no longer in our government. They've replaced God with humanism and socialism. Our nation is a nation of misguided masses because they are completely illiterate of God's Word. They don't know what it says. They've discarded it to the side. Did you know that the Bible is the best-selling book of all time? Did you know that? Worldwide, it's the best-selling book of all time. There have been over 5 billion Bibles sold worldwide. But yet, even though it is America's best-selling book, the Bible is also America's most unread book. How can the world's best-selling book be the world's most unread book? Because people are misguided. In America, we've kicked aside the truth of God's Word. And many now, because they don't know the truth of God's Word, they're susceptible to the Satan's deceptions. Everything now, today, is turned upside down. What used to be held in high regard and well-respected is now ridiculed and omitted. What used to be rejected as deviant and dirty is now paraded and celebrated. And because America is misguided and distracted, they're completely unaware of the impending doom, just like Belshazzar. The city was surrounded, about to come in, and he threw a party. America's unaware because they don't know the truth. They're unaware of the impending danger. America is being surrounded and infiltrated by spiritual demonic forces. America is being surrounded and infiltrated by godless and humanistic philosophies and religions. America is being surrounded by unfriendly enemy nations ready to pounce and destroy us at the most opportune time. America is vulnerable inside and out. We're ripe for destruction. And most Americans have absolutely no idea. Why? Because they're misguided. Wake up, America. Read the handwriting on the wall. Judgment Day is coming. Church, don't follow the masses. The masses are misguided. Wide is the gate, broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many travel through it. But narrow is the gate, difficult is the way it leads to eternal life. And only a few find it. Church, the masses are misguided, and they're headed to destruction. Do not follow the masses, follow the master. Just as happened to the Babylonians will also happen to America because of number 2, blasphemous boasting. Wake up, America. Read the handwriting on the wall. Judgment Day is coming. And it's going to come upon America because of blasphemous boasting. That's what we find in Daniel chapter 5. Look at verse 2 and 3. While he tasted the wine, Belshazzar gave the command to bring the gold and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken from the temple, which used to be in Jerusalem, so that the king and his lords and wives and concubines might drink from them. So they brought the gold vessels that had been taken from the temple of the house of God, which used to be in Jerusalem, and the king and his lords and his wives and his concubines drank from them. Look at verse 23. This is what Daniel had to say about it. You have lifted yourself up against the Lord of heaven. They have brought the vessels of his house before you, and you and your lords and your wives and your concubines have drank wine from them. Belshazzar was nothing more than a rich little spoiled brat. He lived in a royal palace. He slept on silk sheets. He didn't prepare for battle. He instead threw a drunken feast. He even ridiculed God Jehovah. He committed in his ridicule blasphemous boasting. Belshazzar took sacred objects of God, objects set aside and consecrated solely for the worship of God Jehovah, and he desecrated those objects. And he did it with blasphemous boasting by drinking wine out of them as if they were nothing more than Dixie cups. Church, America is also a nation of blasphemous boasting. Just as Belshazzar did, America is also doing, because America is taking the things that are held sacred by God and desecrating them as meaning nothing at all. I mean, just think about it with me for a moment. What things in this world, things that God has given mankind, what things are held in high regard with God, things that used to be held in high regard and very valuable to us, things that America today blasphemes by casting them aside as if they mean nothing at all. And not only has America cast these things aside as worthless, but they're proud of it. What things come to mind? What about the sanctity of life? God is the author of life. God has given all mankind life. We're fearfully and wonderfully made in His image. God knit us together in our mother's womb. Children are a blessing of the Lord. Blessed is he whose quiver is full. But yet America has and is blasphemously boasting against life with the atrocity of the murder of the unborn. To whom God blesses with life, America kills is nothing more than unwanted tissue. And if America's approval of abortion isn't bad enough, America today even boasts about it. Politicians and movie stars stand at the microphone and they shout with pride that they have had an abortion. God help us. But not just the murder of the unborn, there's murder in the streets too. Have you been listening to the news about Chicago? Multiple deaths in the streets of our cities every single day. Wake up, America. Read the handwriting on the wall. Judgment day is coming. There's open, blasphemous boasting against the sanctity of life. There's open, blasphemous boasting against the sanctity of marriage also. God made life and God made marriage before he even made the church. These two things are very precious to God. And America is blasphemously boasting against both of them, the sanctity of life and the sanctity of marriage. No longer is marriage a lifelong commitment between one man and one woman, just as God designed it and sanctified it. The entire institution of marriage has been turned upside down. Heterosexuals no longer even get married. They just move in together, which mocks the sanctity of marriage. Homosexuals are rushing to the courthouse to get married, which also mocks God's sanctity of marriage. Have you noticed that there's even a gay pride month? Not a gay pride day or a gay pride week. It's a gay pride month. Even Jesus just gets one day at Christmas and Easter. Gay pride gets a whole month. America has taken the precious, valuable things of God and cast it to the side as worthless. The sanctity of life, the sanctity of marriage. What about the sanctity of the Christian religion? What about the sanctity of honesty? What about the sanctity of hard work? All of these things America has destroyed with blasphemous boasting. We must call righteous what God calls righteous, and we must call sin what God calls sin. Why will America The great American nation come crashing down for the same exact reason Babylon did. Misguided masses, blasphemous boasting, and number three, false self-security. Look at verse 4. They drank wine and praised the false gods of gold and silver, bronze and iron, wood and stone. Look at the last part of verse 23 now. And you have praised the gods of silver and gold, bronze and iron, wood and stone, which do not see or hear or know. But the God who holds your breath in his hand and owns all your ways, you have not glorified. It was because of Belshazzar's false sense of security that brought his destruction. How did he respond upon hearing that the Persians have risen up and they're conquering the world? How did he respond upon hearing that his own father had been defeated and that his city was surrounded? Did he mount up and fight? Did he call the military to battle stations? Did he warn the inhabitants? No, he threw a party because he had a false sense of security. He was secure in his man-made walls, he thought, in his man-made city. But he also had a false sense of security for his man-made religion. And at his party, Belshazzar lifted up praise for the false gods of silver and gold, bronze and wood, who do not see, who do not hear, who do not live, but the only true living God who gave him life brought judgment down on him. America is guilty of the same thing, this false sense of security in their man-made ideologies and in our man-made religions. America may think she's secure, but she is not. Impending doom is standing at the door. Why? Because of misguided masses, because of blasphemous boasting, because of a false sense of security. Listen, I believe with all my heart that America is going to come crumbling down for these reasons. And going to come crumbling down soon. I believe America has crossed the line to the point of no return. God said it would happen this way in His Word. America is going to end. Judgment Day is coming. But I've got some good news for you. You see, God wants to rescue you from His coming judgment. Judgment is coming, but He wants to rescue you. Well, who are the ones that God rescues? He rescues the repented. He rescues the repented. Listen to this verse and we'll close. 1 John 1:9. For if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God rescues the repented and lays all of our iniquity on His Son. And whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Don't follow the misguided masses. Choose Jesus Christ before it's too late. Wake up, America. Read the handwriting on the wall. Judgment Day is coming, but Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Stand with me, church. I invite you to make a decision for Jesus Christ. Tony's going to come.